Okay, good morning, students. Good morning, everyone. Hello. It's going to be an interactive session, or are the students also going to speak, or they cannot interact?
They will.
Okay. Okay, so before I begin, I would like to thank Dr. Dinesh, the conference team, Amrita University, for giving me this opportunity to interact with the students here. Though managing creative industries or talking about media economics, it's not actually possible to sum up everything in an hour, but I'll try my level best to talk about at least the important factors. Can you see the screen?
Yes,
ma'am.
So we'll be talking about some concepts under media economics and management, how media markets have been performing, how media has been performing, and how media markets are performing, and about media business, some revenue models, revenue and business models in media. And we'll also talk about a Netflix case that might be interesting for you. Let's connect to what happened during pandemic. So if you talk precisely about, say, news media and what happened during, because we can easily connect to the pandemic situation. So pandemic hit the media businesses, as we all know about it. And so what were the changes that were there in the media was, so for a general audience like us, we might feel that, people are glued to television, or they are at home, so they have a lot of time to read or a lot of time to surf on digital mediums. So the media might be doing really great. But the economics of media doesn't work like that. So it actually works the opposite way. The media economics actually work the opposite way during the times of crisis. So when media companies, when actually crisis hit the economy, what happened was media companies started cutting down, or the companies started cutting down their budget of advertising. The fixed cost is what you can't really cut when you are a production company, or say companies like HUL or L&T or P&G. So what do we normally do is we look at the elastic cost, the cost that could be easily cut. And that was advertising cost, which was there. So markets were bad. Nobody was buying goods. These costs were cut. And so the revenue which was coming in the media houses, that revenue suffered. The revenue which was basically coming through advertising in the media houses, it faced problems. So what happened? What were the changes there in the media houses? Was not just the salary cuts which were there. Then there were layoffs that we have seen. Many of these editions were closed down. So the big business houses that we could talk about, say from Times of India to Indian Express, Hindustan Times, Deccan Chronicle, NDTV, Quint. So all of these business houses faced similar kind of situations during the pandemic. And if you look at DNA, so DNA had to close down a lot of editions. Deccan Chronicle had to close down a lot of editions. Then Outlook magazine, it was the first time when Outlook magazine had to actually stop their print editions. If you look at Hindu newspaper, then they had to stop their entire bureau office from Mumbai. The newspaper in Mumbai was completely shut. There were a lot of layoffs also, downsizing was there. So understanding these changes, understanding what's going on in the media, is really, really an important thing for, say, maybe media students. When we know what's happening in the media, when we know about the economy, we also could understand our end users, our consumers. And when we understand the consumers, we can provide content that influences them, that these people like. I hope you are able to connect with what I'm trying to say.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So what happens normally with when we talk of managing creative industries is, let's look at how big is a media industry. So if you look at the performance of a medium, or how big a media industry looks like, let's talk about, say, Times of India, for example. So the turnover of Times of India during the pandemic, so it was just about, say, 10,000 crores. So in the 10,000 crore, or in rough, what we can say is about $1.5 billion. And if you look at other companies in the comparison, so maybe the corporate companies, which is, say, one of this, say, Times of India is one of the biggest powerhouses and one of the biggest medium, and still a turnover of $1.5 billion. And if we compare that with, say, a company like Hero Motor Corp, it has a turnover 3 times more than the media house, has a turnover of turnover 3 times more than what Times of India has. So if you look at the entire media performance or the entire media market, that is how it looks like. The profits that were earned during the similar time period, so the profit that was earned by Times of India during the pandemic or during 2019 was 681 crores to be precise. So that was the 2018-19 period. And in 2020, if you see the results, the profits were even below that due to the economic downturn, which we can say. So the advertising revenue went down, the newsprint cost, which was, and even the advertising revenue, when it goes down, the basic costs that the newspaper incurs, so the newsprint cost or the salaries that were there, the fixed cost remains the same. And if we compare it to other products, say if we compare it to companies like Havells, for example, the turnover for the company is also slightly similar to what Times of India had. But the profits that they had earned was 788 crore during the same period. And so that is how media markets have been performing during the time, during the pandemic. And if you look at the cost of a newspaper also, so the cost of a newspaper is normally what we have is, say, about 4 to 5 rupees is that we normally pay for a newspaper or for, say, Times of India, 48-page newspaper, 48-page main supplement, which is there. And so from this 4 to 5 rupees that audience or a media consumer is paying, there is some amount that goes to the hawker, some amount that goes to the distributor, some amount that goes to the commission, the transportation costs, which is there. So roughly around, say, 40% of the entire cost is 40% of the entire cost, or maybe if we say around 2.40 rupees, so 2 rupees 40 paisa is what is already spent on all of these expenses. The remaining amount is what the media company is getting. And from that remaining amount, if we take the newsprint cost aside, so the newsprint, I hope you understand what it is. Yes, can. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so newsprint is a paper on which we print a new print. So that is what we call as a newsprint. So the newsprint cost is about, say, 0.20 to 25 paisa. So to print a newspaper, a 48-page newspaper, a 48-page Times of India would cost me around, say, 12 to 14 rupees. And the overhead expenses and, say, salaries and considering other expenses, it comes to about 15 rupees. If I have to publish something like Times Life supplement, which newsprint is what I am not getting, so I have to buy that newsprint also. The cost of the newspaper becomes about 25-26 rupees, the publishing cost, the printing cost of a newspaper. And with that printing cost, when I am sold a newspaper as an audience, when I am sold a newspaper at 4 to 5 rupees, so there is some economics that goes behind it. So it's not just about the advertising revenue, but about a lot of things that go behind making a newspaper or maybe selling it at such a cost to your audiences. So that is what basically media economics talks about, or media management talks about. So looking at media as a product, or say newspaper as a product, if we say, so there are newspaper or television or films as a media product or as creative industries. There are some differences that a media, how is a media industry different, or how is a media product different from other products? So there are some peculiarities that are there. We'll just look at these and then go to the next slide. So the basic law of scarcity, if you guys have studied economics anytime, so the basic law of scarcity doesn't apply for all the media products here. So if, say, I consume a film, that doesn't mean that it gets used up. So you can also consume a same film, or you can also consume, or you can also, if I see a particular, say, if I see Bachchan Pandey, that doesn't mean it gets finished. So if you it gets over like a normal product, so you can also consume it maybe on the same platform or on a different platform also. So that is one feature of a media product. It is not merely a commercial product, but we can term it as a cultural product also. Though we have some business and revenue models that we talk about. And normally the resource allocation is done through a pricing system for normal goods. So if you have a life buoy that is sold for about, say, 20 rupees, 15 rupees, 20 rupees. But that doesn't happen with YouTube. So you have something called the freemium model, which is there, where an audience might not even pay for what content you are getting. So there are some advertisers who are paying for the content. There is something called as a dual market structure, which we'll also be talking about. So that is again a peculiarity or a particular feature of a media market that we can talk about. And the content that we consume doesn't get destroyed. So it could also be passed on to the next person. So there is the concept of diminishing of a product is not what is there with these media, with media as a product. So that is also one of the feature of a media market. And the economic problem, if we say how media industries allocate their resources, is what we look at under managing these kind of creative industries. So how are they looking at these people? How are they looking at technology? Who are the people? How can we allocate resources and come out with a better outcome? So if you have limited resources and then you plan to make a video, so how best can you use a particular technology to make it? What is the content that you plan to create? And how is that content going to be useful for your audiences? So we look at certain algorithms. We look at some structured data. We process that data. And once we process that data, we have some content. We have something called as programmatic. As a concept, we'll also look at that. Looking at all these things, how do we come up with certain content that is useful for a particular niche category of audiences, and how? Understanding that performance, so that is also one of the economic problem. And the third problem here is who are to meet the needs of advertisers and societal. So meeting the needs of the advertisers, meeting the needs of your audiences. So when we talk of markets, media markets, there are two different audiences here, or it is actually a dual product market, something which is not similar. If we compare it with other commercial products, this is a unique feature of our media markets. Have you looked at this anytime? A dual product market structure?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so here in media, so when we talk of media, it is not just the media product that you are selling. So a media product, what do I mean by a media product, is a film that I am producing, or a newspaper that I am talking about, a newspaper that I am coming up with, or maybe a television series that I am coming up with. So that is one kind of a product which is sold to your audiences. And the other product here, other important element here in your dual product market structure is the advertisers. So your audience are then sold to the advertisers. So the more audiences you have, the more advertisers you are going to attract. So if you look at Times of India, it is going to have a certain readership figure, a readership number. The more readership figures the Times of India is attracting, the more advertisers they'll be getting. So that is how it works. So the first product here is the content that the media companies are developing, and the second product is your audience themselves. So that is how media functions in a dual market structure. So this concept is from Robert Picard's book Media Economics, which is published in 1989, and he had mentioned this concept, the dual product market concept here. Okay, you can stop me anytime if it gets too much into economics or too much into something that you're not able to understand. Okay. Now, when we talk of a media marketplace, what does it look like? Or which are the main components which are there in the media marketplace? This is what Philip Napoli has also mentioned in his book called as Audience Economics, where he talks about a marketplace and comparing it to a commercial product and which are the elements that are there. So the first is your media organization. the one who is giving content to you, so, or the content provider. So it could be a television or a radio station. It could be certain websites. It could be the media producers or say a newspaper publishing house who is publishing content for you. So the first element in the media marketplace is your media organizations. Then we have audience measurement organizations also. So audience measurement organization is something like BARC, which is their Broadcast Audience Research Council, who gives us television rating points, TRPs. Or we have Indian readership surveys, we have national readership surveys, or Audit Bureau of Circulation. So that is for the newspapers. For radio, we have radio audience measurement, which is there. Or we have something called as Nielsen ratings, which are there, or Comscore data. So all these are what we call as audience measurement organization who measure your audiences. And so this audience measurement is required for your advertisers also. Obviously, it is required for media firms also. As well. So if say I am Z TV, and I subscribe to BARC and get my TRP, so I can also change my content as per the ratings that I have. But for an advertiser also, he has to look at these ratings so that I know whether I have to advertise in Sony or I have to advertise in Z or maybe neither of it. Or if on Sony, then what slot do I advertise in? So for an advertiser also, these things are required. Then, is there anyone who's trying to say something in between?
No, ma'am. You can continue.
Okay. Then we have advertisers as a third element in the media marketplace also. So advertisers or say consumers of the audience product is what we can term as advertisers, where we looked at the dual market structure. So they are the consumers of this audience as a product there. And so for advertisers, there are two things which I have combined in and put them as advertisers. So one is the actual people who are advertising. So advertising their products and services, so companies, MNCs, corporates, so all these people who are planning to advertise, they are the one. There are also advertising, media planning, media buying agencies who are also a part of it, who are giving advertising or producing and distributing advertisements to the through a particular medium. So they are the third major element of your media marketplace. And the fourth one is obviously you and me, the consumers. Under consumers also, we categorize the consumers as predicted audience, measured audience, actual audience, as per the measurement ratings. We'll look at that also later. But normally what we do is we classify them as digital natives and digital migrants also. So people like you would come under digital natives who have seen digital mediums from a particular, or you're born and brought up with digital mediums. And say, or people like me could be considered as migrants, where we have been started using digital mediums after a particular age. So your consumers, again, there are different segregations. Okay, this is what Philip Napoli mentions in the audience market, as audience marketplace also, or a media marketplace. So we have some consumers, and then the data goes to media audience, data is collected through media audience and firms, and then it goes to the advertisers, and it's a circular process which is there. So I just thought I'll just put this for reference. Okay. So with the pandemic situation that we spoke about, and a lot of companies coming up with certain changes due to pandemic, and so post-pandemic also there are a lot of changes that media companies have come up with. Or today if you see say Hindustan Times, look at the website that Hindustan Times is having, and they have video content also on their website. Or look at NDTV, and they have text content also. So it is not just restricted to a broadcast medium or just restricted to a print medium. So there are certain changes that are happening in the business models of these MNE or media and entertainment companies. So what are these changes, or what are the core areas which are there? So if you look at content, then we have regionalization and hyper-localization as two most important things which are there. So you talk to audience, you get the algorithms right, and then you produce certain content which is suitable for your audiences. So understanding the audience is an important or a core area when you talk of your business models or when you talk of rethinking about your business models. Then we have distribution as also one of the element which is there. What do we mean by distribution is now that we have, say, if you look at, say, Bachchan Pandey, which is released. So Bachchan Pandey is released on Amazon Prime. I hope you have seen it or you know about it. But yes or no? Okay, so this movie which was released, where do I actually release the movie? So should I release it on Netflix or should I release it on Amazon Prime or maybe Hotstar, or I go for only theatrical releases, or should I also go for aggregators, aggregator sites, say for like Jio Cinema or like Tata Sky, where I can show it on two or three different platforms also. So which of these mediums should I now use for distribution? So earlier it was just a theatrical release, and so the entire distribution was maybe easier, and then the amount of, and then the economics behind this distribution was also easier to calculate. But now when I am showing this movie on Amazon Prime, what I am doing is missing on the audiences who have taken Netflix as or subscribed to Netflix, or who have not subscribed to Amazon Prime, and then other things. So I am just maybe missing on those audiences. So that is again a core area, core business area that people need to think about when they are talking about business models for media. Then the transaction which is there. So if you look at this movie Radhe, which was released, a Salman Khan movie during the pandemic. So what Radhe did was they released the movie on Z5 that time. So there were a lot of, they did wait for a lot of time, and then the theaters were not opening. And there was a multi-platform release for Radhe. So it was released on two platforms. So one is this TVOD service, which Z has, Zplex, and the Z5 OTT platform, which was there. And then the views that they got. So they had a separate pricing policy that they had introduced, where you could subscribe to Z5 for a certain period, watch Radhe, and then at a particular amount, which was obviously very less as compared to the theater cost, but they could still earn a lot of profit. There were 4.2 million views which was there on for Z5. And what happened after that is the Z5 was suddenly so popular. So they had this Friends episode, the Friends reunion episode, which was released at the same time. And it was simultaneously released in US and India also. So there were a lot of strategies that they planned around this transaction, what Z5, and then around the Radhe movie, which was planned. And then the fourth one is your customers. So understanding your consumer, who is the one who is actually consuming your content, and what are the strategies that he would want or he is looking at. So giving me Netflix, and so Amazon Prime comes up with 129 package for rupees 129, and suddenly say Hotstar comes with a 149 package, and Netflix then has to come up with a 199 package for a month. So these, because this is what maybe the audiences want, or you have an aggregator site like Tata Sky who's looking at all of these and then offering you a package that pays certain amount and get all of these under one. So these kind of understanding your consumers' needs and providing them with certain discounts, providing them with a particular content that they want, is also one of the core element in while you design your business models. Looking at the trends that are there in the media industry. So one is algorithm that we already spoke about. So understanding AI or content recommendation for marketing intelligence, or which kind of content is your audience preferring? So going for structured data, semi-structured data, or going for in-app analytics and certain algorithms is what is in trend. Then broadband bundles is one of the major thing that is also earning a lot of revenue. So sites like InShorts, which I'm sure you would be using, or sites like Daily Hunt, which is there, or Tata Sky, which is giving you a bundle of offers. So it is not just one medium that you can look at. So I need not just subscribe to Times of India now. I can subscribe to Daily Hunt and get a range of newspapers or read a range. Or something like Maxter, which is giving. So Maxter has newspapers, they have magazines, they have books, everything under just one head. So that is what that is also what media companies are offering. Then we have engagement also, which is also an important revenue earning source, or maybe how engaged is your customer with your product. There is one, I'm sure you would have seen this Social Dilemma documentary. Did you see that? The Social Dilemma film on Netflix.
Yes.
There's a short video which we'll see. Just let me know if you are able to hear the sound also. Are you able to hear the sound?
No.
Okay, just let me stop sharing.
Depending on where you live.
Yeah.
When you go to Google and type in climate change is, you're going to see different results depending on where you live and the particular things that Google knows about your interests.
That's not by accident. That's a design technique.
What I want people to know is that everything they're doing online is being watched, is being tracked. Every single action you take is carefully monitored and recorded.
A lot of people think Google's just a search box and Facebook's just a place to see what my friends are doing. What they don't realize is there's entire teams of engineers whose job is to use your psychology against you.
I was the co-inventor of the Facebook like button.
I was the president of Pinterest.
Google. Twitter. Instagram.
There were meaningful changes happening around the world because of these platforms. I think we were naive about the flip side of that coin.
We get rewarded by hearts, likes, thumbs up. And we conflate that with value, and we conflate it with truth.
A whole generation is more anxious, more depressed.
I always felt like fundamentally it was a force for good. I don't know if I feel that way anymore.
Facebook discovered that they were able to affect real world behavior and emotions without ever triggering the user's awareness. They are completely clueless.
Fake news spreads 6 times faster than true news. We're being bombarded with rumors.
If everyone's entitled to their own facts, there's really no need for people to come together. In fact, there's really no need for people to interact.
We have less control over who we are and what we really believe.
If you want to control the population of your country, there has never been a tool as effective as Facebook.
We built these things and we have a responsibility to change it. The intention could be, how do we make the world better?
If technology creates mass chaos, loneliness, more polarization, more election hacking, more inability to focus on the real issues, we're toast.
This is checkmate on humanity.
Okay, so those who have not seen this documentary, I think you should see it once. Or maybe you can screen it in your office, in your college. So engagement is one. Now there are different ways to engage with your audience. Like this documentary says, okay, you can have a look at the documentary. I don't want to disclose what they are trying to say. But there are ways to engage with your audience, to understand the audience better, to understand the consumer behavior. So that is also a trend which is there. then we have programmatic, so that the ad doesn't go waste, and then the increasing with this increasing number of mediums. So if I talk of digital, or if I talk of online mediums, so there are so many of these online mediums, and then some other, or if I say about digital mediums, I might think of around 100 ways in which I could advertise on digital mediums also. And under digital mediums, should I only go for social mediums, or should I also go for conventional media for advertising, or should I go for 360 degree advertising also? So all of these, to save all of these revenue, I have something called as programmatic, which is an option that people say. And then we have an... Just a minute. Okay, then we have something called as extended reality, which is also in trend, where the content flows from the physical world to the virtual world, and how basically you can do all of that. There are multi-gaming platforms also, a lot of people into esports and NFTs these days. So multi-gaming platforms is also one of the popular trend which is there, which helps you to earn a lot of revenue. OTT platforms that we all know. Now, OTT also has different revenue streams, revenue generating options. Like we have AVOD, or advertising video on demand, SVOD, which is subscription video on demand, or transactional video on demand, TVOD, or we have a freemium model, which is also there, through which we can actually, or they are basically the source of income for you. And then there is something called as influencer economy also. So what influencer economy talks about is, say if you have looked at these, or in simple terms, if I talk about, say, social media influencers, okay, look at what Trajecta Kohli does. Those who are there on social mediums looking, or Instagram, there is this lady called as Prajakta Kohli, mostly sane, aware about it? A social media influencer? No? Yes.
Yes, ma'am. We know.
Yeah. So, I mean, she's very popular.
She's
so,
very popular.
So, promoting it. And then now if you look at the, say, Media Ant, which is a media planning, which is normally used by media planners to decide where do you get advertising. There is also one part there. They have TV, print, and all of these as options. But one of it is also influencers these days. So these influencers to talk in their video. So Prajakta Kohli talks about a certain product in her video, and then she charges some amount for it. Those are also part of the mainstream media these days. If you look at Media Ant website, you can see that. See the cost, and then say if you have to just talk the entire video about her, and then so what is the amount that she's charging for that. So this influencer economy is also on a rise with, so these are basic trends. And apart from these also, so there are NFTs, digital assets, which are their upcoming trends in media. Then there is something called as K-pop culture, which is very prominent, hyper-localization, which we spoke about, connected TV, which is there, or maybe people moving from personalized, say family viewing or social viewing platforms to a personalized viewing platform. So now, say people in your generation don't look at television as a source of consumption, entertainment consumption, but you have your personalized mediums. So sitting in a family, sitting with your family and then watching TV is no more in trend these days. Okay, so if you look at some figures, of course, I'm not going to stress on it. Maybe it's too much of numbers for you all. But if you look at the entire, so this is from the FICCI report that I have taken. If you look at the media entertainment sector, the key trends that are there, and how did the economy perform, how did the media entertainment sector perform during the last year, we can see that it recovered by about 16.4%. If we compare it to the earlier figures, but we are still short by about 11% if we are comparing it with the 2019 figures. Television, though it still remains as a prominent medium, or the largest medium, digital also has a better position. So look at 221 as a number year, and then what are they estimating in 2024 is something like 527, which is 21% rise is what we are predicting. So the expectation for 2022 or this year, which the report is what we will have in the next year, is 17% growth. About 17% growth is what we are expecting in 2020, by the end of 2022. And if we look at the future of these mediums and the key contribution of the sectors, if we talk about is digital films and TV, which together contributes to about, say, 65% of the entire revenue that is earned, and then followed by animation and VFX, which is 14%, and then followed by online. So this is what is the future that we can see. So digital films and television is still to grow. Maybe the mediums, if we talk of television, maybe the way in which we are consuming, the device through which we are consuming these mediums could change, but the content could obviously also change, but television still remains prominent. So there are some things that I have just put up. So television became connected and interactive, films have released online. So these are also some things that are there if we talk of 2022. And news has become hyper-local now. So it is not just news from, I don't know about your place, but if I say about, say, Mumbai, so it is not just news about Mumbai that we are talking about, but a particular area in central Bombay, if we say, and in central Mumbai also, maybe a particular residential area that I stay in, and then I get news of those areas also. So news has become hyper-local. I get regional content also. So over 390 million Indians have gamed online. Esports is on rise. So I don't know how many of you are there in esports, but the pandemic has made a few changes, obviously has led to a few changes. And one of this is when the sports was screened off online and people have started gaming also online. So esports is prominent and songs have been streamed online. The OTT subscription has gone up. Subscription, there are two reasons why OTT subscription has gone up. One is the Jio, because of Jio, we had, because of Reliance, we had a lot of people having an access to digital technology also. And so that was one reason. The other one was the pricing policies that these mediums also had, the OTT mediums. When I subscribed to Netflix, it was about 500 rupees that I had to pay for a Netflix 1 month subscription. But now they have come down to 99 also. So that accessibility, there could be a larger number of audience who could subscribe to these services then. So that is what has changed. So in doing all of these. All of these things, obviously, digital and technology has played a prominent role, and then they have started talking about customer data. Customer data through algorithms, through in-app also, and through companies like Nelson, through media research companies. And then, so the companies which were media companies earlier, now we can also call them as media science companies. And the media and entertainment sector is obviously, it did not grow much in 2020, but can see it's there on the rise. Okay, this is something from an economic perspective. I hope I'm not boring you guys.
No, ma'am. No.
Yeah, early in the morning media economics session.
No, ma'am. It's very interesting and informative.
Okay. So if you talk of, if you look at, say, I'll not go into the model or into the economics of it because I'm not economic students. But if we look at this industrial organization models, there is something called as market structure, market conduct, and market performance. So on the basis of something like a market structure, so how many buyers, sellers you have, if I look at print mediums, so if I have Times of India and then similar newspapers in that area, and some local newspapers, some national newspapers, and how different are these products from one another? So how different is Times of India from Economic Times? And if there is a local newspaper which has to enter, or maybe a national newspaper, what are the barriers for its entry? What is going to be the cost structure? What's the vertical integration or any mergers acquisition? So depending on all of this, your market conduct, I mean, your market conduct is based on all of these things. So market conduct is, what is the pricing that I have to fix? What are the mediums that I need to advertise in then? So, and on the basis of both of these things, the market structure and the market conduct, your market performs, the market performance is based on both of these things. So how efficiently is your market performing, or what is the growth that's there in your market? So that is basically based on your structure and your market conduct. So this is again explained by S. Scherer. This is a book called as Media Economics by Alan Alberin. Alan Alberin is one of the famous economists, media economists who's there. He writes articles, research papers, books on media economics. So he spoke about this industrial organization model, and this could be used to evaluate your market. So if I have to talk about print market, how do I evaluate a print market is on the basis of these three factors. Now we'll talk about something that might interest you. So like the revenue model and the business model for media companies. So if I talk of revenue source, this is again picked up from a book by Awards. And he talks about the 4C model of analyzing a medium. And then revenue generation or revenue source is basically the way in which, or the source in which I could earn revenue. And there are four parameters here, four ways in which, or four things that I need to consider. So one is content, obviously what I need to put, which kind of content do I have to give, or which kind of content does sells for the advertisers. And then some commerce or some context also. Context is basically classifying the data or systematic classification of your data. And then there is something called as commerce, which is involved. So how better am I going to publicize my data or put that data to the audiences, through which mediums, or what is the cost that a medium is going to incur, and how am I going to provide this information to my audiences? So based on these things, my revenue source is also depends on the revenue source. And then I have something called as revenue form. Revenue form is, where do I get revenue from? For whom is this service charged for? So me as an end user, is this service charged for me? And how is this service charged? So when I say a $1.99 pack, there is a $1.99 subscription package for, say Netflix. There is a lot of research that goes behind, which Netflix has already done, and then offered you a $1.99 package or a $1.49 package. So when Radhe was released, there was a team who was working on these multi-platforms for Z5 and Zplex. And then they decided, okay, we are going to charge 49 rupees, or we are going to charge 59 rupees so that people can view Radhe through a medium. And when I say revenue form, there are these different revenue forms that are there. One is direct revenue, one is indirect revenue, and then there's something called as transaction revenue and transaction independent revenues also. So something like commission, which is charged, so it is indirect revenue and transaction based. Or when I talk of transaction independent revenue. So transaction independent revenue is which is not connected to customer usage, where transaction based is connected to your customer usage. So the single unit purchase which is there. So it is based on how many times do I purchase a newspaper. So according to that, this revenue is based on. So this is nothing but the revenue form. Who are the people I'm charging, and what am I charging them from? So that is another revenue a revenue form which I can say. Then where do I get this money from? So combination of revenue source and your revenue form is this revenue type which is there. So revenue type is nothing but these are some five main revenue types. Where do I earn money from? So one is single unit purchases. So I go to a newspaper stall, I purchase a newspaper, and then I pay for it. I'm not a subscriber. So that is one source of income. Then there are subscriptions. Then there are commissions which are there. So commission is like a media planner that you hire, and then you buy mediums through a media buyer, and then you charge say 16.7% of commission to him. So, or you have a newspaper stall which is there, and then to keep your newspaper there, you have some commission rates that are fixed. Then selling your data, selling the data, your user data is also a source of income, which is there, which comes under revenue type, and then advertising, which is quite prominent. On the basis of all of these things, we have something called as a revenue model, which is fixed. And so for some companies, you could have a revenue, say you could have a revenue model for which is just single unit purchases. So for example, there's a newspaper, or say for example, you have say a particular magazine where there is no subscription, only single unit purchase, which is available. So that is what comes as single unit forms. But normally you have these combinations which are there. So it could be single unit purchases and subscriptions. So something like Reader's Digest, you say. So they subscribe, we can subscribe to it also. And then we can go to a stall and purchase them also. There are 31 of these types that you can create. I have not put all of those in the slide because it becomes difficult then. But there are 31 of these you can combine, and then that is what your revenue model talks about. That is what is your revenue model. Through these revenue model, what we can come up is a business model which is there. Now this was just an explanation of the revenue model. So Apple's music, okay, this is taken from the Apple website. So Apple's music business is what runs on single unit purchases and subscription plans, as most of you would be aware. So this is how we apply these to our mediums. That is why this example was put up here. And as far as they claim, as far as Apple Music company is claiming, there is no revenue type such as seller. They are selling user data. That is what they claim also. But selling user data is also one of the sources of revenue which is there. And then we come up with something which is more important here is a business model. So how is a business model for media companies developed is through these four elements. The first one is a value proposition model. Value proposition model is what services are offered to your end users, what services or what content you are going to offer to your end users. And then we have something called as value creation model. So how is this service provided? Through which medium am I providing these services? And how am I going to package the service and then provide it to you? Then there is something called as a revenue model, which is also there. So how am I going to earn revenue through it? So now that I spoke about the content, now that I know that how am I going to deliver that content, then how am I going to earn the revenue for it? So that is the third thing. And then the fourth one is the customer model, which is there. So who are these customers that I'm going to target? So once you have all of these into place, we can form a business model for a media company. So I need to know my customers. I need to know my where am I going to earn money from, what is the content that I am delivering, and how am I delivering that content. Once we know all of these four, then we have something called as a business model, which is also there. So a media consumer, who is a media consumer and what does a consumer want is... Okay. Then so what just okay, so when we're talking about a media consumer, or maybe explain who a media consumer is, someone who likes bundle, someone who likes quantity of... who likes quantity, who likes bundles. So bundling could be something like a daily hunt, which we spoke about, or in shorts, which we talk about. So the more news on in shorts, the more a consumer is going to pay. or the more amount of bundling kind of aggregator sites that we have. So we are going to pay, we are ready to pay for those sites also. And we subscribe to global OTT platforms as well. So we subscribe to Netflix, but with Netflix, we would also prefer watching Z5 or we would also prefer watching YouTube. So we are not leaving these sites, but going for global OTT platform also. So what we do is what a media company wants, what a media consumer wants is something like an escape from your reality. If you look at this uses and gratification theory, which we would have earned, which we have learned during graduation. So that also mentions about why do we actually look at mediums and what are the uses of a particular medium and what are the needs that are satisfied through it. So so if we provide your end users with the content that they want, or maybe the content in their language, a localized content is something that would really work. So that is what Netflix also did when it started in 2015-16. They came up with something called as Secret Games. People were not subscribing to Netflix, but the time that they came up with Secret Games, people suddenly started subscribing because we could connect to Secret Games and not to the other things that were there on the on Netflix. And apart from this, then we have obviously real-time data, which is also there. So customer data is what goes, or people pay for the customer data as well. So that is also what a media consumer is. Also, if I'm getting YouTube for free, that's sure that someone is earning money because I'm watching YouTube for free and using my data. Okay, then if we talk of audience product, so a consumer as a product, then we have something called as predicted, measured, and actual audience. So predicted is something that a company predicts. When you have a target audience defined first, so I have some, I have say 1 million audiences that I'm going to reach. And from that 1 million, I have say a bar data or a TRP that shows me from the 1 million, you have only reached say a particular 1,000 number, a particular lakh numbers. So that is what a measured audience is. Audience who come under the measured category, whom I can measure. And then from the measured ones also, if there are people who are caught under a TRP scheme, their numbers are reflected. But who are those actual audience? So what TRPs or what these television audience ratings, television rating points, how do they calculate it? Say if I'm just surfing through the channel also, and if I'm there on a channel for more than a minute, that gets calculated easily. And so this is, these could not be actual audience also. I'm not even looking at a television program. Maybe there's some advertisement which is going on and I'm not looking at those ads also. But still I'm getting calculated through those. So the actual audience is also, then in the actual audience figures. So I need to understand all of these three to actually know which audience do I reach. And then there is managing media, a global view, and then these are certain things that are a global perspective about how media companies are doing. So content distribution is more complex because we have more mediums now, and simplified and customized experiences through VR, AR, or say customized experiences or improving something like immersive mediums. So that is what is in trend. Then movies will be returning to theaters, and then the source of earning for movies through movies is also going to increase. Then regional hyperlocalization that we spoke about. Mergers and acquisition is still a popular thing which is there, especially global players coming in India, investing in local, investing in the local content, and or maybe production companies that could come up with local content. So that is again there as a global perspective. And NFTs, which is there, NFTs, so people spending for through NFTs on esports, on shopping has also increased widely. And so that is also a major source of earning for the media company. So this is what is a global perspective that I'm talking about. Okay, that is all what I had to say. There was a Netflix case also, which I had to discuss, but I think there's no time left for it. I'll just take up some questions if you have any.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the wonderful session. Now we have a question answer session. Participants from both online and offline can ask questions if you have any.
Ma'am?
Yes,
yes. myself, Kartika. First of all, it was a great pleasure to listen to your talk. It was highly informative and interesting. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Since you have mentioned about influencer economy, I would like to know what's your comment on major brands approaching influencers for branding over traditional media. Do you think it's an effective method?
Yes, so it again depends on the audience that you want to reach. Say, for example, if I'm looking at digital migrant, a person who is at the age of 50, so for them, maybe influencer marketing might not work. So if there is a person who is using Instagram, someone like digital natives, for them, it might work. So it again has to be a customized platform that you use and not just go for influencer and or not. But these days, companies are also offering packages with where they have customization with conventional and non-conventional. So if you look at media and they have a customization package for influencer as well as newspaper, television also.
Yes, yes. Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Anyone else wants to ask anything? Yeah, I think there's a person I can see on the screen.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
I'm myself, Nandu. My question is, OTT platform has been rising nowadays, and the subscription fees is very low as 99 rupees or 199. Ma'am, whether there is any other source of revenue for this platform other than the subscription fees?
So there are subscription, there is advertising video on demand also. So earlier it was just subscription, but now if you look at Hotstar or if you look at Amazon Prime, they have started with some advertisements also. And then there is something called as transaction-based, there is something called as freemium model. So all of these are also a source of income. But these are subjective, that we see that the amount is low, maybe 99 could be low, but the range of people who are subscribing to it at 99 rupees is very huge.
The content they are producing is also very high. And the purchase and, of the movies is that 40 CR per movie. So is it very possible for only the subscription fees?
No, so it is not possible. Frankly, it is not possible only through subscription fees. But because these are not released on theaters, so if you look at the recent one, say Bachchan Pandey released on OTT, instead of fact, it was released in theaters also, but the range in which it was released was not similar as compared to 2018, which was there. Obviously, you earn more revenue because theater itself has its own economy. So it is not just the theater, the movie which is caused, but the entire, the popcorn and the other things that you have, that is also a source of income for, say, PVR or for the theaters. And that also gets collected in the movie revenue, or you have, a music release which is there, and then there's the revenue that you earn through a music release. So all that is combined. But when you have no other way than to just release it online, but these days companies have started releasing online as well as theater releases are also started. The amount is obviously low, the revenue that you generate.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Hi, ma'am. I'm Lakshmi Ravindra. It was nice listening to you. Ma'am, my question is different from what you said now. Regarding the media economics, there is influencer marketing on one side, there is data tracking on the other side, there is behavioral retargeting on the other side. So what is what is advertisement industry doing to retain the media ethics?
So if we look at digital, then actually we do not have any. So that is self-regulation. We do not have any media ethics to be there. What is the industry doing? It is just the ASI, the Advertising Society, the code which is there, ASCI code which is there and which is applied right. For advertisement. So that is only which is there in place. Otherwise, it is just self-regulation. And see, this ethics regulation is again a very subjective thing which we can say. Though there are different ways, so if you have, say, surrogate advertising, which is there, though we have a lot of ethics and a lot of regulations, codes, which are mentioned, but still there are So I think it's a very subjective question. Ethics for me would not be ethics for you also. So.
I also have a doubt. Why are some ads not skippable, unskippable on YouTube?
Because they pay more. Because they pay more for it, for the audience. So we spoke about the dual product market where the advertiser, for an advertiser, you are the audience. So the more amount of audience you have for a particular video, the more amount of ad that video is going to attract. And so it will have non-skippable ads also. If you have lesser amount of audience, so you will have those ads which could be skipped. So it depends on the audience that you have, and then it depends on the number of people who have viewed your YouTube ad or YouTube video which you have uploaded. So it depends on how rich your how influencing your content is, and how many more audience, for how many more people you are able to attract. On the basis of that, advertisements are put there, and the people who is putting those they earn through it.
Also, ma'am, my third question would be on, you spoke about e-gaming, e-games. So how do they calculate revenue from, is it based on subscription?
So e-gaming or e-sports, if we say, there are subscription fees for e-sports. There are companies who deal only in e-sports. So you go there, you play your sports, you give a certain amount, and then you start playing. The more amount you earn through it, so it's a game that you actually, it's similar to an actual game, but just played online, where you pay some amount and then you pay, then you play a particular game. But there are companies through which you can do these e-sport activities. For an individual, it's actually not possible.
Right. Okay. No, I have seen some adver. There is a new technology on adver games. So I was thinking on how the media economics play on that.
So there are companies. There are e-sport companies. There are gaming companies that are there. Say e-gaming is a different thing than e-sports that we talk about. E-gaming could only, okay. Gaming and sports is also a different thing. So gaming is something that I just play online through my say Xbox or through my system, through my machine. But esports is something where I need a company where I go, or a place where I go, and then I play that game through a machine, through a particular system that they have. So I need to spend some amount there to play. Whereas when I talk about gaming, I just purchase a game and then I start playing it on my Xbox.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Any other questions?
I hope I did not take a lot of time. Did I cross the time limit?
No, ma'am. Yeah. Hi, ma'am. Myself, Anuvinda. So you talked about movies being released online into OTT platforms, and we have certainly seen a certain amount of increase in recent time. But the thing is, most of us prefer to download these movies via Telegram or torrent or other illegal platforms. So it creates such a financial loss for the content creators, right? So how do they overcome that?
No, so that is overcome by people like me or people like from a earlier generation who would go in the theater. And see, these things, when you release a movie online through a digital platform, some leakage of the content is obviously there. So you can't just expect that. So earlier, what Mozabear used to do when there were CDs which were there, so the we never used to buy the original music CDs, but we used to buy the Mozabear ones, where we have a collection of those songs which we get at 30 rupees. Because these, so some kind of leakage, some kind of content leakage is obviously going to be there. You do not earn money from those things which are circulated through these platforms, but you have other ways of earning revenue then. So that is what is explored by the companies. So if you see a particular movie, so if you see Radhe being circulated also, or maybe Bachchan Pandey being circulated through your Telegram link also, which is quite popular. I mean, people do get it. But then there are a chunk of audience who would go to Amazon Prime, who have subscribed to it, and then watch that also. Or there are a chunk of audiences who would go to a theater and watch that movie. So that is where the revenue comes from.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
And then and there are so many other sources of revenue generation also, which is not possible to be discussed in an hour. Okay, any other questions?
Namaste, ma'am.
Hello.
I'm Hari Krishnan. I'd like to hear your comments on the authenticity of data from these audience measurement organizations, like TAP ratings.
Okay. See, if we talk of BARC, for example, Broadcast Audience Research Council. So I was a part of their research team for Mumbai a few years back. What they do is, so in Maharashtra, if you say, there are 30,000 meters that are set up. So these meters are the one that get data, through which we get data. Now, Maharashtra is such a huge place that just having a 30,000 sample size is very small, very small a number. And then again, if you talk of, so these are the data that they get from urban audiences. Rural is what they just started a few years back. So getting an authentic data is something which is obviously a question, but if you are not subscribing to them, to these sites, then you're not getting any data at all. Or you go to Nielsen, and then if a company is able to spend more, then you obviously subscribe to Nielsen and then have a customized research done for your company also. Or get some data which is already there for the there. So, but these measurement organizations, if you look at NRS, IRS surveys also, or if you look at BARC, or if you look at listenership, viewership, these, I cannot say that they are manipulated officially, but we have already looked at certain news articles where they know how they have been done. But a weekly data which is given is something that is useful for the companies, and that is how they change their working also. So if I am, say, a news organization and then I get the BARC data every Thursday, then I can change my content or tweak my content a little so that I know what kind of depending on what kind of content people prefer. So these changes could be, this kind of things, these kind of changes are possible because of these organizations.
Okay, thank you.
The authenticity is something that is again a question. I mean, I really can't comment on it, but you require a media research agency or a market research agency when you actually want to get some authentic content.
Okay.
But if someone is interested in looking at data, maybe you can go to this BARC website, and then there is a section called as methodology there, where they explain what is the methodology that they are using for collecting data, and then you will understand how unauthentic that could be.
Thank you, Anushka, ma'am. It was a wonderful session.